Hello, I'm Gypsy Metellus, and welcome to Haitian Voices. May is Haitian Cultural Heritage Month throughout South Florida, and what better way to celebrate culture if not through food? Today, we explore the colorful diversity of Haitian cuisine and how South Florida's chefs are keeping Haitian gastronomy alive and well. Today, we welcome Chef Dominique from KC Healthy Cooking, Chef Thia and Chef Irie, both from Caribbean cooking programs Taste the Islands, premiering nationally on Public TV's Create Network in June and right here on South Florida PBS in July. So it's a pleasure to welcome all three of your Haitian voices.
Hi.
So what wonderful conversation we're going to have today. So let's get a sense of who you are in terms of your own trainings and I guess your specialty. Let's begin with you, Chef Dominique.
My name is Jerry Dominique, uh-huh. And I was graduating at Le Cordon Bleu Institute in 2011.
Okay.
And then right after that, I opened KC Healthy Cooking in North Miami, where we do more fusion with Asian cooking and also do vegan.
Okay, that's wonderful. That's a wonderful, so it's vegan and healthy cooking,
yes.
But Haitian style.
That's
very good. Chef Thia, what about you? What about your training?
Oh, my training started very young. You know, traveling the country, you know, with my grandparents, cooking with the people around the city. And also when I moved to the state, I said, you know, I think I'm going to further my education. And I went also to Le Cordon Bleu, like Chef Dominique, and to further my education. But more my experience is learning with different chefs, you know, work with different people, hotels, fine dinings, you know, I kind of went a little bit of everything to further my education and actually specialize in one thing.
Okay, which is? What do you specialize
in? I specialize more into my Haitian, my roots, and I fusion it with different countries, you know, the one that I really fall in love with, you know, like Africa, you know, the French, the Italian. So we have a lot of similarity and I kind of use it and blend it.
Oh, sounds delicious already. Chef Irie, what about you?
Hi, how are you? How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
It's awesome to see you today.
It's nice to see you.
Well, for me, wow, this is interesting. So I'm a former architect, now chef.
And cooking is architecture.
Cooking is architecture. Yes, it is. You know, so we're always building and erecting and constructing. So I went to Johnson & Wales here in North Miami. So I'm a grad. I'm an alum, JWU. And for me, cooking has always been a part of my life ever since I was young, but it wasn't the path that I normally would have chosen living in Jamaica, which is where I'm from, until I came and to the States and went to culinary school and worked several establishments, catering, restaurants, hotels. Now that I ply my trade, it's all about the Caribbean, Caribbean food, Caribbean culture, and how I fuse, if you would, our culture on a plate, you know, one ingredient at a time.
So you said that your professional career should have been architecture, but then you moved towards food. In spite of the similarities there might be between cooking and architecture, but what brought you to cooking, actually?
Like I said, that was always a part of me growing up, and I think it got pushed more to the forefront when I was in college. And I think when you're in college and, you know, it's all about survival mode.
So you were creating dishes.
Yes, so you got to cook to survive. But friends there would tell me, you know, you should really check, you know, explore this more. And of course, so I think when seeds are planted, they oftentimes take a little while to germinate until they start to sprout and then you start to listen. So once that happened, it was time to listen.
There you go. Yeah. And for you, Chef Thia, I know that, first of all, we don't encounter many women chefs, right? And I also know that though many of us like cooking, many of us are Haitian American, we love to cook. Cooking is part of our traditions, family traditions, etc. But that's not necessarily widely widely supported in the culture.
Especially in the island. When I, you know, when you grew up in Haiti, they see you as a a lawyer, a doctor,
a teacher, an architect, or an engineer.
Right. Those are the ones, or you know, you're a mom, a full-time mom, and you make babies and raise them. Mm-hmm. And for me, at my time, it was a challenge because I went against the whole entire family. I said, listen, I want to be a chef.
Right.
Everybody was like, seriously? Right. I'm like, yeah, I've been cooking, you know, every day. And in Haiti, it's so cheap to pay for someone to cook home the amazing food. So I'm like, I want to cook and I want to be the chef and I will show you. And for me, it was more of like a dare, like, yes, I can be a chef being a female. Mm-hmm. And yes, I can be accepted. Yes, I can go far. And yes, I'm able to have a living from that career.
That's important.
And I made it. I went to college, graduated, you know, top, and went to the most prestigious hotel in Miami. Mm-hmm. And from then I kept growing. And I had amazing chef work with me doing this time, and they kind of pushed me and said, listen, you have a talent, you have something very unique.
And so how is this seen by your family now that you've
and now
all this
now it's
and
like, when are you coming to the house and cook for us? Okay. Oh, can you do a live? Oh, can we do something? So it's now it's more acceptable.
Okay.
And then I'm amazed, and it's such a pleasure to see how many Haitian chef women, female, are actually choosing this career. So for me, I know it wasn't a waste. I know it was stronger than anything because it came from the heart. You know, it was
blazing a trail. Yeah. Man, good for you. And so Chef Dominique, what about you? Did you always want to cook?
Not really.
What do you want to do?
Actually, I love to eat.
Okay.
But I was raised in a family that my mom, my grandma,
all the women,
that's what they do. And mm-hmm. and then in we were eight in the house.
Wow.
So,
it's a big family.
A big,
a lot of mouths to feed.
Big family. Uh-huh. Actually, my dad had 54 kids, so that's another
story. Absolutely. So, but what did you want to be before you moved on to cooking?
But before I switched cooking, I graduated as an engineer.
Okay.
And in 2009, I just decided to take a break from engineering.
Okay.
My kids got big enough to
and now you're doing something you're passionate about.
So I start.
Okay. Very good.
Cooking.
Very good. So I'm sorry. Finish that thought.
No. So on my cooking, that happened because I went to the doctor one day, and then they told me that I'm borderline
diabetic,
and my cholesterol also. So they may have to put me on pills. So I said, why? I used to play soccer, so I was very active. And then I thought, no.
Okay.
I knew exactly what I need to do.
Okay. So at that point,
I started changing the way I eat.
Okay,
but I didn't want to move away from my culture. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, I'm going to use it and balance what I eat.
Okay, fantastic. So, and I know that your place gets rave reviews, especially from either people who are vegetarian or folks who are very healthy minded. And so that's a good thing. So now let's move into cooking and into food. So what's your favorite dish to prepare, Thia?
Whew, I love food. So for me, it's really, really hard. I love anything grill, anything that's on the grill. Like, you know, I just create on the grill. When I'm on the grill, I'm living.
Okay.
The heat, the noise, the way the meat tastes, it's just
the
like
sizzle.
Chef Irie.
What does it sound like, Irie?
So it's really the grilling part. Mm-hmm. I because for me, every time I would go to a place and I would ask for a grill meat, that would send it so dry, and that I just master that piece of meat. It has to be like very juicy. So for me,
perfectly,
I would say meat.
The perfectly grilled piece
yes.
of meat. What's your favorite dish?
That's like the $64,000 and $1 million question.
Yes.
I don't know if I have a favorite dish to make, but I do have favorite dishes that I eat, and usually that's within my Jamaican culture. So, okay. You know, curry goat, oxtail, stew peas, mm-hmm. and I'm a purist, you know, when it comes to stew peas. For those of you know, red beans and pigtail and you know, stew peas, it has to have those, you know, accoutrements in there. But I think as a chef, you know, you get asked that question all the time,
I know.
Whether in an interview or just people just curious. And I think for us, it's always you're always moving from one dish to the next. Because you're always creating. Mm-hmm. Today, yes, this was a great dish, and you loved it. I love it too.
But tomorrow you're gonna love something.
I want to have something, you know, even greater or better.
That's why it's so hard to answer.
Yeah.
Do you have an answer to that question, Chef Dominique? Is there a favorite? No. Okay. So
no.
We're gonna leave that alone. So you love everything you do, and every day you're creating, you're coming up with new things, and so you fall in love with your cooking every day, right?
Oh, yeah.
But then, do you specialize in a certain cuisine, or do you just continue to just infuse your heritage or your the spices from your heritage into these new things that you're creating? You're shaking your head, Irie.
Oh, yeah.
So you go ahead and tell us about that.
Yes, at least for me, I know.
What's the process like?
You know, I think it's the process comes over time. When you leave culinary school, you're trying to find your way. If at all you went to culinary school, you just started in the business. You're trying to find your way, your identity, whomever you've worked for. And when you start doing your own thing, now you start to apply you. And so for me, learning about our Caribbean is sort of like my goal, my ambition now, not just to just cook my cultural Jamaican cuisine, but to understand what all the other islands represent. Mm-hmm. So having the opportunity to have gone to Haiti, to have gone to Cayman, Trinidad, you pick up bits and pieces, and having people that you know from those places, you start to understand their culture and how it relates to what you're doing. Mm-hmm. So the spices, the flavors, the ingredients, a lot of them may be similar, but they're cooked in so many different ways and techniques.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So for me, I want to learn those techniques. I want to learn their culture, part of their history, so I can have better understanding of what it is that I'm doing for a certain dish.
I see, and you can eat
both
of you can weigh
in. And the way he said it, it's, you know, when you come, any career you do, you get out of college, you finding yourself. But for me, it was different because they had a career before they went to food. To me, learning from the street vendors, learning from the people who work at other people's house, learning from restaurant, my mom owning a restaurant. So I was already exposed into the food. And for me, it was to understand how come something so simple, like our épices, mm-hmm. okay, can create so many diversity of type of food and flavors. And it's all about the technique. I can give you my recipe of my épices, you know, and I cook my rice and you cook your rice, and it's totally two different things.
It's true.
And even doing the taste the island, I mean, the islands, it's like, it's simple, you know, it's the same épices. I said, yeah, but you taste it, it tastes different. So I learned, why is it that my people using something so strong and magical, and they're able to create the rice, the griot, the cabrit, the legume, and we're using the same épices, but everything tastes so different.
I'm getting lost in each of those items as you're describing them.
And that's
hungry.
Why I fell in love. I was like, wow.
Do we have lunch?
You put the clove. You put the clove.
Don't go there, Irie. You put cloves and you put garlic.
In the griot, it's to know why they use it. It's like an antiseptic because we don't have fridge in Haiti. We don't have electricity. So our techniques, it's a little bit more flavorful with more spices and more acid, is because we don't have a way to store things.
Right.
Compared to if you go to Jamaica, they may have a little bit of more, it's poor, but not as poor, so you'll find more people with a fridge compared to us in Haiti. Mm-hmm. So when those vendors in the street, I went, it's because I cook with them. I cook with them, I was with them, I went to their place.
So you learned the techniques,
I learned from them, I learned to get to know them, I learned to... to actually understand why is it that they use this so much.
Okay.
And I learned that by learning about my spice, about my herb. What is it about the parsley? What does the parsley do? What is the effect of everything? And when you combine them together, how come we live so long? And how come every Haitian, you get up in the street, we happy? It's because of the herbs, it's the spice.
It's garlic, all that. Huh?
Yes, okay. Of course. Yes.
So is there, this is a question for all three of you. Is there a food, is there a dish that you've not yet made that you're looking forward to being able to prepare?
Ooh, that's interesting. Actually, yeah.
Yeah. Tell me though, what is that dish, and where geographically do you place that dish?
Mm. Ooh, Mediterranean, and I would say Mediterranean. I think understanding Italian dishes a little more.
Okay.
It's a place that I want to go to. So there's two places.
In
Italy, and Mediterranean.
And Thailand. Oh.
So understanding the complexities from the various regions within Italy and also Thailand, and understanding the street food of Thailand, because that's like...
It's like the street foods of Haiti.
Yeah.
So, delicious and aroma.
Yeah.
What about you, Chef Dominique? Same question. Is there a dish that's situated somewhere geographically? Is it in Africa? Is it in Asia? Is it
not really for me in particular, if you've been to the restaurant, we have people that come in and they just look at the menu and said, "Oh, chef, can you make something for me?" Mm-hmm. And then I will go ahead and create something for them.
Okay.
So that person brings
the ideas,
the flavor, everything they need, and they just have to put it together.
Okay.
So it bring that creativity on every single piece, on every single recipe that you bring to the floor.
Okay.
So if you look at my menu in particular, that's one reason you will see a bunch of names. It's actually Stevie Rapp or the Seda Cupcaker, for example.
Okay.
It's they said that's somebody from Washington.
Okay.
She came in one time to a restaurant and said,
"Can you make this for me?"
And
you
said, "I love this. Something. I like this thing that." I said, "Okay,
and
sure."
You automatically create
yes,
on the
I'll make it.
That's interesting.
It for you.
That's interesting.
It's more for me. It's more about to bring the Haitian culture, the Haitian cuisine.
Mm-hmm.
To the next level.
Okay, okay.
Because most people know us about the griot, the bon paise,
the rice and beans.
But since I'm more focused on the healthy side, I'm trying to bring people, hey, you know, there's something called legume.
You can have it and it's
you
not
can
as
have
fattening.
It any time you want. And it's good for you too.
Okay. because and it's not cooked with all that oil.
No. Yeah.
Okay.
If people knew that you have lunch a militant, for example, charité. On 100 gram, you have only 10 calories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's fantastic. What about you, Thia?
Oh,
Where is it that you want to go cook?
I went Asia, I went Italy. I there's a lot of similarities. But me, it would be tagine, the African, because it's so huge, it's so vast of Africa, that every part of it, they have a different way of doing the tagine. Like for us, we have the griot. In Cap Haitian, they do it a certain way. In different places, we use coconut. Some of them use, you know, so it's so base that for me, it would be Africa to find my roots a little bit deeper, you know, and how they do the tagine the same way we do also our type of food. But then it reminds a lot of the Spanish world with the paella, you know, but the tagine, there's something about it that I just want to get deeper to it. So it would be Africa.
Okay.
I know something you want to say real quickly.
Uh-huh.
You know, as much, you know, we all, you know, have had experience in different types of cuisines. One of the things that I understand, once you get to the place of origin, your understanding
better.
Totally changes, and your perspective
True.
Of the food and the culture changes tremendously.
I can appreciate that.
Because once I went to Haiti, yes, I know I have a lot of Haitian friends and I've cooked Haitian food, but being there, it transforms your mind. You know, it transformed my mind. So, you know, when you're there in the place of origin, you are able to now
understand,
you know,
so that difference of Thia really comes alive.
Yes, Thia. So you, the people, and you, especially if you're able to go, you know, house to house.
That's the best part in Haiti.
So let's get to a very important question. So there's students watching you right now. There are young people watching you right now who love your foods and are inspired by you. What's your advice to them? Let's begin with Chef Dominique. What advice would you have for young folks who may want to go into this field?
I will tell them just follow the dream and to understand, just like Chef was explaining, to understand where they're coming from and where exactly they want to go.
To follow their dreams.
Yeah.
And I said youth, but this really applies to anyone because, you know, many people could drop their careers right now and move to cooking because it's a passion.
I mean, I can say my dream was not to be to be a chef.
You were you were an engineer.
I just happened, this I one day say,
okay.
It seems to be, since I love food that much,
let's go engineer some good food. Same question to you.
Me, it would be discipline, and
please,
and more,
please define discipline.
Discipline means wake up in the morning at a certain time and focus on what you want and your goal. Don't say I want to become a chef because you think there's money. Yes, there is, but if you think you're gonna go to school and come out and then boom, make money. Then you're going to start to be like, oh, I don't want to be there. So you have to have a mix of passion. You have to have the discipline. You have to have the will. Because it's all about the will and wanting. And then from once you have those three, then you can go anywhere in this world with this career.
Fantastic.
You know, and that would be
your
advice.
And you, Chef.
So I got twofold. So students.
So not just students. This could
I'll
be just
with students. Okay. So I think if you're a if you're someone, young, you know, that wants to go into culinary, be absolutely sure that's what you want to do. Especially if you're going to go into culinary school. One, it's expensive. Two, you have to understand from a mentor. You know, have a mentor before you go in. Have a mentor while you're there. Have a mentor after you come out, because I think the road to success is hard, it's long, it's arduous, and if you're not committed to seeing that through, you're gonna fall by the wayside.
Okay.
If you're thinking that you're gonna come out and be a superstar, you need to pay your, you need to pay your dues. You need to pay your dues. And I think a lot of the way television and social media is right now, everybody wants to be a superstar. Everybody wants to be a superstar. And I think anybody else that's you know, if you're switching careers and stuff like that, the same, you know, do, you know that's what you want to do. And I think once you've started that journey, understand that there will be ups, there will be downs, but if that is your passion, because I didn't realize I had a passion for food until I went into the industry.
And I want to take the audience to a little clip of Taste of the Islands. I want you to have a look at the passion of Irie and Thia. Let's take a look.
So, we are making curry goat. It needs to be soft, tender, and spicy. All of that yummy goodness on a plate. Season up the goat. And we'll do that with a little pepper and salt, some allspice, coriander, paprika, chili flakes, and garlic powder. When you add the curry, make sure all the pieces get coated, and then add a little cumin as well. As I said, no white rice or rice and peas, so we're actually serving this with our breadfruit pumpkin salad.
Oh my goodness, and now we've got pictures of Chef Dominique's breadfruit, creative, gorgeous, healthy cooking. Let's take a look at those. Oh, yummy. We'll see the cupcake with tuna. Oh, mine. Oh,
that's pretty.
Okay, then coconut curry with salmon. Mm. Oh, look at that black rice John in the John. Middle.
Is that a jonjon?
Oh my goodness, yes, that's a jonjon. That's and I think a double portobello burger. Ooh, yummy, yummy, yummy.
Nice.
Oh my goodness, my goodness.
Well, like
that. And now that I'm totally hungry, it's a good thing we're out of time. And so thank you so very much for joining us today on this episode of Haitian Voices. And be sure to catch Taste of the Island with Thia and Chef Irie for season 2. And this premieres on Saturday, July 1st at 3:30, right here on South Florida PBS. And I'm Gypsy Vitalis. Thank you so much for watching.